तकलीफ़ उठाना पड़ती है, मेहनत करना पड़ती है, तब कहीं जाके आपके सामने एक किताब आती है इस अंदाज़ की। तो अब यही है कि मुझे हैरत यह है, इतनी किताबें लिखते हैं, अभी तक कोई किताब इन्होंने नाक कान और हलक के बारे में नहीं लिखी। वो शायद आइंदा का प्रोग्राम होगा, लेकिन जो इनकी तबीयत है, जितना मैं इनको जानती हूँ, अगर ये कभी किताब लिखेंगे नाक कान या हलक के बारे में, तो उस किताब का उन्वान यही होगा कि न सुनो गर बुरा कहे कोई। अभी कराची में जलसा हुआ था इफ्तिखार साहब ये किताब का, तो मैं ज़ाहिर है इनकी सआदत मंदी है, मुझे बुलाते हैं। उसमें हमारी एक जो एंकर पर्सन थी, जो मॉडरेट कर रही थी, वो बहुत मशहूर एक आई स्पेशलिस्ट हैं, महनाज। तो ये दोनों थे, एक आँखों के बड़ी ज़बरदस्त डॉक्टर हैं, दूसरे हलक कान गला वगैरह सब। तो मैंने कहा इन लोग, ये लोग यहाँ आजकल क्या कर रहे हैं, इन्हें तो इन दिनों इस्लामाबाद में होना चाहिए। पूछे क्यों? मैंने कहा एक लीडर ने कहा तो है दो दफ़ा कि वहाँ सब अंधे गूंगे बहरे रहते हैं, अब वहाँ जाएँ तो इन लोगों के बहुत ही मतलब वारे न्यारे हों। तो इस तरह की हम बात कर भी लेते हैं इनकी किताब के बारे में, लेकिन सीरियस बात यह है कि एक आदमी, अपना मसरूफ आदमी, एक वक्त निकालता है, जगह जगह शहर ब शहर जाता है, उन जगहों पे जाता है कि जहाँ लोग अक्सर नहीं जाते, जगह वहाँ तस्वीर खींचता है, उनके बारे में मालूमात हासिल करता है, और फिर कहीं एक किताब आपकी नज़रों के सामने आती है। ऐसे लोग काबिल क़द्र हैं, हमारे माशरे में इनकी कदर व मंजिलत इनकी डॉक्टरी के अलावा है। मैं बहुत बहुत मुबारकबाद देती हूँ इफ्तिखार सलाहुद्दीन को, और मुझे यकीन है कि आइंदा जब इनका सेशन होगा तो स्क्रीन वगैरह का इंतज़ाम मुंतज़मीन को बहुत अच्छा करना चाहिए, क्योंकि ये तस्वीरें इतनी खूबसूरत हैं कि अगर ये वाज़े तौर पे आपके सामने ना आए। अभी हबीब यूनिवर्सिटी में जब इस एक किताब का हुआ, तो उन्होंने बड़ी स्क्रीन लगाई हुई थी, और किताब जेरूसलम के बारे में थी। आप यकीन कीजिए कि जब तकरीर ख़त्म हुई और लोगों ने वो तस्वीरें देखी हैं, तो सामईन की और नाजरीन की आंखों में आंसू थे। तो ये चीज़ें हैं जो हमें तस्वीर में और डॉक्टर साहब के लबो लहजे में नज़र आती हैं, और मैं बड़ी खुशी के साथ डॉक्टर साहब का खैर मकदम करती हूँ, और मुझे यकीन है कि आप इनकी तस्वीरों को और इनकी तहरीर को दिल से यकीनी तौर पर इंजॉय करेंगे। वो आप सबका बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया।
हेलो, मौके नहीं है भाई, तीसरी बार ज़हरा आपा, जिस खलूस और शफ़क़त से आपने मेरा ज़िक्र किया और नसीम का भी ज़िक्र आप हमेशा करती रहती हैं, तो मैं हम दोनों की तरफ से आपका बेहद मशकूर हूँ। ज़हरा आपा का जो उर्दू और शायरी में एक बुलंद मुकाम और मर्तबा है, उसका किसी को सब जानते हैं उसके बारे में, और ज़हरा आपा आपका यहाँ होना न सिर्फ मेरे लिए बल्कि सारे लोग जो मौजूद हैं उनके लिए बायस इज़्ज़त है। ये हमारी नई किताब जो अभी शाया हुई है, इसमें ज़हरा आपा ने हमारी बहुत रहनुमाई की, और सच तो ये है कि उसमें जितने शायरी और अशार का इंग्लिश ट्रांसलेशन है, सब ज़हरा आपा ही की मदद से किया गया है और उन्हीं के इंतखाब से किया गया है। मैं ज़रा पा आपसे बहुत मशहूर हूँ, आपको मशहूर हूँ, थैंक यू आपने यहाँ तशरीफ़ लाए कराची से इतनी दूर और हमें इंट्रोड्यूस किया, और नसीमा मेरी तरफ से अगेन आपकी तरफ बहुत शुक्रिया आपका।
बस एक अर्ज़ और करना चाहती हूँ कि हम किताब के शुरू में डॉक्टर साहब कह रहे थे कि क्या कुछ मैं लिखना चाहता हूँ, तो मैंने कहा जहाँ तक मेरी समझ में आता है, आपको अपनी किताब के शुरू में अल्लामा इकबाल का एक मिसरा लिख देना चाहिए कि मेरी तमाम सरगुजश्त खोए हुओं की जस्तजू। तो अब आप देखिए खोए हुओं की जस्तजू को,
जरा आप यहीं तशरीफ रखेंगी, आप नीचे,
मैं नीचे जाऊंगी, आप क्यों मुझे नुकसान में डालना चाहते हैं, मैं वहां से तस्वीरें भी देखूंगी।
Now, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here this afternoon, and I am thrilled to be in Lahore. It's very rare that I get a chance to speak to the audience of Lahore. And this afternoon, although Zehra has concentrated on a new book, I will talk about Iran and the legends of emperors and kings. Iran is an ancient land, and its history dates back to about 5,000 years. It is very difficult for me then to plan when to start or where to start the story of this fascinating land. So I have chosen to go back 2,600 years and start the story from the 6th century BC. And this seems to be an appropriate period because this was when the first Persian Empire was founded. In the 6th century, many significant events were happening both in the West and in the East. Around this period, Western philosophy as we know it began in Greece. And this was the pre-Socrates period of Pythagoras and Thales. In the West, another important event was taking shape. Roman monarchy was overthrown and the Roman Republic was being established. While these important events were happening in the West, in the East, Confucian philosophy was being founded in China, and Gautama Buddha was spreading the message of enlightenment across the East. Next door to Persia, in Jerusalem, a great tragedy was unfolding. The Babylonians entered Jerusalem and destroyed the Temple of Solomon, which the Jews held so sacred. They forced the Israelites to flee Jerusalem, and many of the Israelites then settled in Babylon. In fact, they were taken prisoners to Babylon. It was in these times that the first Persian dynasty of the Achaemenid rule was founded by Cyrus the Great. Historians feel that Cyrus was not just the emperor of Iran or Persia, but he was the emperor of the world. And he established an empire in one generation which stretched from the Aegean Sea all the way across to the Indus River here. And it is interesting to see that Iran, which we now call Persia, is just a small part of the Persian Empire then. The Persian Empire also included western part of Pakistan, Central Asian republics of Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and extended all the way up on the Aral Sea, up into the Aegean Sea. So this was the extent of the large Persian Empire which the Achaemenids had founded. Cyrus was the ultimate king, and he was central to the history of Persia. King Cyrus believed on Zoroastrian faith, which preached compassion and justice. And in neighboring Babylonia, the king Nebuchadnezzar was oppressive to the Jews who had come from Jerusalem. Cyrus couldn't take that, and he declared war on Babylonia, and he freed the Jews and gave them money and silver and gold and asked them to return to Jerusalem to build the new temple. President Netanyahu and the rest of the Israelis would do well to remember that the nation which they hate so passionately today was the one who set up the temple and helped them at that time. In fact, Cyrus the Great is mentioned in the Bible with grace and honor. Today, only the Wailing Wall is what remains of the Second Temple of Jerusalem. In the British Museum is preserved the Cyrus cylinder, which is the clay cylinder which the British discovered in Mesopotamia just recently, and it has the history of the emancipation of Jews written on it. To celebrate many of his victories, Cyrus built the city of Pasargadae, and this was somewhere where Shiraz, the city of Shiraz, now stands. Today, only the mausoleum of Cyrus stands in the midst of the ruins of Persepolis, of Pasargadae. After Cyrus came Darius. And the new king, as all kings do, wanted to make his own city. And he made the city of Persepolis, which is the Greek name for the city of Persians. This is what Persepolis looked like then. And the Iranians still regard Persepolis as their national identity. Alas, this is Persepolis today. But Persepolis, among the ruins of the world, is ranked as one of the most historically significant, and many tourists from across the world come to see just the Persepolis ruins in Persia. These are the few images of the city of Persepolis as we see it now. I wish the screen was large, you could have a better idea of the pictures, but unfortunately even we don't have this screen working. So let's do with what we have. Okay, fine, thank you. Persepolis is also the burial place for many of the kings of the Persian era, but the most celebrated king, Darius, is not buried here. Darius is interred about 30 kilometers from Shiraz, in the mountains of Naqsh-e Rustam. And over centuries, nothing remained in these burial chambers of Naqsh-e Rustam. After Darius, Persia was plunged into prolonged wars with the Greeks. And these Greco-Persian wars lasted for over 20 years. In one of the wars, Persians reached the city of Athens, and in a savage move, attacked the icon of Greek history, the Acropolis. And they burnt it down, and with it, the Parthenon and the Temple of Athena. The end to the Greek-Persian wars came at the hands of Alexander of Macedonia, who in the 4th century marched across Babylonia and descended on the city of Persepolis. Alexander, the student of Aristotle, and the man who worshipped at the altar of truth and beauty, in a senseless act, ordered the destruction of Persepolis as a revenge for the destruction of Acropolis in Athens. Before the city went up in flames, the Greeks required 10,000 horses and thousands more camels to cart away the treasures of Persepolis. Thus began the Greek rule over Persia. After Alexander's rule, a dynamic leader by the name of Ardashir rose from the region of Fars, which is around Shiraz now, and he eventually founded an empire called the Sassanid dynasty. The significance of Sassanid dynasty is that it is the last pre-Islamic dynasty of Persia. Since Sassanids ruled for 400 years, and it was the most illustrious period in Persian history, which witnessed the renaissance of Persian culture. The art which Iran is famous for, the miniatures, the domes, and the carpets, all have their origin not in the Muslim Persia, but in the pre-Islamic Sassanid period. The most magnificent carpet ever built by man was made under the rule of the Sassanids, and the ruler was Khosrow, and this carpet was called Spring of Khosrow. This unique carpet was a rich blend of gold and silver. Emeralds were used to show the leaves, rubies, sapphire, and pearls used for blossoms. When the Arabs conquered Sassanids in the 7th century, the troops of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq took the carpet away to Medina, and guess what they did with it? They cut it into pieces and gave it as a gift to the victorious army. The Sassanids, like the empires before them, were followers of Ahur Mazda, and for 1,000 years, beginning with Cyrus till the end of the non-Muslim rule, the Zoroastrian faith was the official religion of Iran. 30 kilometers from Isfahan, is the sacred city of Yazd, and it is the home to the largest population of Persians, of Zoroastrians in Iran. They come to this Atishkadeh, where the eternal flame has been burning for the last 700 years. Generally speaking, the Iranian history has two distinct periods, pre-Islamic and Islamic. Up to now, I have talked about the pre-Islamic period, and the two important Islamic, rather pre-Islamic dynasties were the Achaemenids and the Sassanids. Just after the passing away of our Prophet in 632, the Arab armies faced two mighty adversaries in the north, the Romans and the Persians. These are the Arabs right here. But the Romans and the Persians were at war with each other for such a long time that they had sapped their energies and they were weak and vulnerable. The Muslims were waiting for this opportunity, and that came to them in the year 634. In 634, under Abu Bakr Siddiq, the army humbled the Persians and occupied Damascus. Persia was next, and that happened in the reign of Hazrat Umar, who with his famous general Khalid bin Walid defeated the Persians at the Battle of Qadisiyah and occupied Ctesiphon, the capital in Mesopotamia. Persia was now under the Muslim rule. The great institutions of Persia before Islam were monarchy and the Zoroastrian faith. With Islam, both were swept away. Iran was first ruled from Medina, and then for 90 years later, it was ruled from Damascus. The Persians of Khorasan, who were believers in Hazrat Ali, revolted against the Umayyads, and then after defeating them, moved the capital from Damascus to Baghdad. The reality was that the land with distinct Persian ethos was now being ruled by the Arabs from Baghdad, and with them they brought a new religion, a new culture, and most importantly, a new language. Over the next three centuries, the Persian script would then adopt the Arabic way of writing. The unique fusion of the Persian and the Arabic culture and its languages encouraged scholarship and philosophy in Iran or Persia. The glorious Muslim rule during the Abbasid Khalifa Mamun, a center of learning was made, and this was called Bayt al-Hikmah. And although Bayt al-Hikmah was in an Arab capital, most of the philosophers who enriched this place were Persians, but not Arabs. There were several renowned scholars in this important place of learning, but three deserve recognition. This is Avicenna, as Zarapa just alluded to his Qanun, and he was not just a doctor, but a philosopher. And his book, Qanun, was a required reading for the medical institutions all over Europe. He was from Afshona in Uzbekistan. The other was Biruni. He was from Beirut, Uzbekistan. He was an historian and an astronomer. Of course, we all know about Al-Khwarizmi, the father of algebra. He was from a province of Al-Khwarizm, again in Uzbekistan. Over years, when the Abbasid government and governance in Persia came unraveling, central authority was lost and regional dynasties took power. One result of this breakup was that the Persian language lost its moorings with the Arabic and it came to its own. In fact, in this period, some of the most sublime and beautiful and fragrant poetry in Persian was written in these periods. The rulers of the minor states supported the artists and the philosophers, but one ruler from Ghazni supported and helped poet Abdul Qasim Firdausi who wrote the Shahnameh. The Shahnameh is the epic story of kings who ruled Persia before Islam came, or shall I say before Arabs came. It is also a legend we know of Rustam and Sohrab, and Shahnameh is huge. It has 50,000 verses and was written when Arabic was pervasive in the land. So the interesting thing is that Shahnameh does not have even a word of Arabic in it. It's completely 100% Persian. And the work extols the pre-Islamic kings and Zoroastrian ethos. Firdausi laments the coming of Arabs, but not the coming of Islam to Persia. And if Shahnameh had not been written, the history of pre-Islamic Iran would have disappeared with the Sasanids. It took 30 years for Firdausi to complete the work on Shahnameh. And then he took it to the Sultan of Ghaznavi, and when he presented it, the Sultan didn't like what he read. He was upset that the ethos was more Zoroastrian and there was praise for pre-Islamic kings. So he gave a few gold coins to Firdausi, and when Firdausi left the palace, he gave half the money to the wine seller and the other half to a bath assistant. But later, over the period when Firdausi's benefactor read the Shahnameh properly and completely, he was very impressed by the work and he sent a camel load of gifts to Firdausi. But when the camel laden with gifts came through the city gate, Shahnameh's funeral was leaving through the other gate of the city. The camels ultimately reached the house of Firdausi, but his sister refused to accept the gifts. When Abbasid land was finally broken up into several minor states, a Tatar tribe called the Seljuks rose from the region of the Turkic area in the Central Asia and marched down towards Persia. In the 11th century, they occupied entire Persia and made Isfahan their capital. The 11th century Iran under Seljuks was a brilliant period for architecture and creativity. This is the Jama Masjid of Isfahan, made by the Seljuks, and it is depicting the rich architecture of the Seljuk period. The Seljuk architecture is very interesting because of the extensive use of bricks. And this is another example. Even the intricate calligraphy on bricks is evident in the mihrab of the Seljuk mosque. Again, it is in Isfahan. The Seljuks were also patrons of art and literature, and a profusion of poets and Sufis flourished in the period of the Seljuk era. The most well-known is Umar Khayyam. Now, if you read Fitzgerald's translation of Umar Khayyam, you'll come away with the belief that Umar Khayyam only wrote about wine and women and luxury. But Umar Khayyam was a great scientist and a mathematician and an astronomer. In fact, a crater in the moon is named after Umar Khayyam. The other was the jurist Al-Ghazali. He was a philosopher and very orthodox philosopher. And he was from Khorasan. The Seljuks ruled for about 100 years. And the 13th century, another great power rose from the east and from Mongolia, and the leader was Genghis Khan. Genghis Khan had had enough with wars, and he wrote a letter to the Muslim leader in Khwarizm province that, look, we have had enough with wars, we do not want to have war with you, we want to trade with you, and he sent a delegation of about 10 or 15 people, among them a couple of Hindus. The leader of the Khwarazm province was a very arrogant ruler. He blackened the face of the representatives of Genghis Khan, he shaved the head and sent them back. Now, Genghis Khan was not the man to be trifled with. He came with his entire force, and what is important is he led them personally, and he came and destroyed Bukhara, Samarkand, Khiev, Urgench, and Khorasan. The Mongols occupied the entire Persia and made Tabriz the capital. During the period of Mongol invasion, it is interesting that the poets and Sufis and philosophers also thrived in Persia. Among them, three deserve special mention. Rumi was a poet, a Sufi mystic. He was from Balkh in Afghanistan, which you know was also part of Persia. And when the Mongols invaded Persia, he escaped to the Anatolia province, which is now in Turkey. He flourished there and he was buried in Konya. His poetry and his philosophy is still very popular among not just the Persians, but all over the West. Another celebrated poet was Sa'di. He was born in Shiraz. In the world of literature, he is famous for his book Bostan and Gulistan. Sa'di is buried in Shiraz, and his mausoleum is a popular place for the young and old who come to read his poetry inscribed on his cenotaph. A century after Sa'di was born Hafiz Shirazi, and his magnum opus was Divan. Most Iranian homes have a copy of Divan, not just for the love of the poetry of Iran, but they use it as a fal. Whenever divine guidance is needed, they open the Divan and get the guidance from it. Hafiz, although he was a Hafiz himself, led a very hedonistic life, frequenting taverns and nightlife, and he was persecuted by the extremists, and to whom he replied, "O zealots, the difference between the infidel church and the mosque is but vanity." When he died, he was denied a Muslim burial. So they decided to consult his Divan again, and they finally thought that he was good enough. He came through and he was buried and given a decent burial and buried on a hill, which is shown right here. This is just outside Shiraz. That was Iran of poets and Sufis. After the Mongols, up until the 15th century, Iran was predominantly Sunni. In fact, from the Ottoman Empire came scholars to study at the Sunni madrasas in Iran. All that changed in the 16th century when a militant Safavid ruler came to the land of Mongols and Seljuks, and he established the Safavid dynasty. Now, Safavid dynasty is not to be confused with the Sassanid dynasty. Sassanid dynasty is a pre-Islamic, non-Muslim dynasty. Safavid is a Muslim dynasty of Iran. To start with, all Safavids were Sunnis, but in late 16th century, a leader called Shah Ismail came to power and he decided to assume an identity distinct from the Sunni Ottomans, which are next door neighbors. And he proclaimed Shiaism as the official faith of the land. For Shah Ismail, Iran was defined by two realities, Shia religion and Persian culture. He ordered forcible conversion of the Sufis and Sunnis to Shiaism, and he introduced the offensive tradition of Tabarra, which required the Shias to denounce the first three Khalifas of Islam. In the Safavid dynasty, the most celebrated ruler was not Shah Ismail, who enforced Shiaism, but Shah Abbas, who patronized art and architecture. He moved the capital to Isfahan, which today has the most impressive galleries of Islamic architecture and art in the world. All the grandeur of Isfahan is from the period of Shah Abbas, who ruled Iran for 40 years. The present government of Ayatollahs have changed all the names associated with Shah Abbas, and the new names reflect the period of the Imams. The Naqsh-e-Jahan Square is the heart of Isfahan. Around this are located the jewels of Persian architecture, and Naqsh-e-Jahan's name has now been changed to Imam Square. This is a popular place where all the young Iranians come and meet and have picnic. This is Naqsh-e-Jahan at dusk. And at night, it looks a scene from the Thousand and One Nights. The most beautiful mosque in Iran is the Sheikh Lutfullah Mosque, and that name has not been changed. The mosque is finished in blue tiles, and I would let you enjoy the images of this lovely mosque. It is a very peaceful city with gardens and parks, and I think when I retire I'm going to settle in Isfahan. It's so beautiful. Back to the political history of Iran now. The imposition of Shiite ideology by Safavids bred intolerance of the Iranians against not just the non-Shias but also against the Sufis and the Zoroastrians and the Baha'is. After passing away of Shah Abbas, the Safavids led the country for almost a century. The end to the glorious Safavid rule came at the hands of Sunni Afghans, and they were from Kandahar. But their rule was very short-lived, and after a few years, the Afghans were routed by a nationalist by the name of Nadir Quli. He would be remembered in history as Nadir Shah. And I must emphasize that Nadir Shah was not Afghan, but he was an Iranian nationalist. Nadir Shah reoccupied Afghanistan and declared himself king. And in one farman, he ordered the cessation of the all Shia practices offensive to Sunnis. He banned the Ashura procession and confiscated all the Shia mosques in Persia. But he did not impose this Sunni ideology on the country. After occupying Kandahar, Nadir Shah accused India of harboring the fugitives from this area, and in a hot pursuit, he headed for Delhi, where Mughal Emperor Muhammad Shah Rangila was on the throne. Muhammad Shah Rangila was so engrossed in song and dances that he made Nadir Shah wait for 2 months before even granting him an audience. And Nadir Shah was not about to be insulted like that. He attacked and occupied Lahore, occupied Peshawar, and he killed 30,000 people only in the city of Delhi. The defeated Mughal Shah Rangila sued for peace and ceded the land west of Indus to Nadir Shah. Nadir Shah did not intend to annex the Mughal Empire, but he was only interested in the wealth of India. He looted the peacock throne and he took it with him to Persia. The peacock throne was originally built by Shah Jahan in the 17th century. It was embellished with precious and semi-precious stones. And after returning from India, Nadir Shah was killed by his own soldiers and he was buried near Mashhad. And after his death, the peacock throne disappeared. Perhaps it was broken into pieces and sold all over Persia. This is the replica of the peacock throne in the Gulistan Palace in Tehran. And the Nadir Shah's troops took away the Kohinoor diamond, and which is still in the crown of the British Empire, and it still weighs 180 carats. So Nadir Shah didn't take just the peacock throne, but he took the diamond, the Kohinoor diamond, which ultimately found its way to India. Then the British Indians gave it as a gift to Victoria, which is still there in the crown. After the death of the Sunni ruler Nadir Shah, Iran would not remain Sunni for long. And again, the next dynasty of Zand restored the Shia faith like a pendulum. And all over Iran, there was significantly celebration for the revival of the Shia faith. Significantly also, the Zand dynasty opened Iran to the foreign countries. The stories of dynasties continues, and after Zand came the Khajar dynasty, whose ruler was Fatih Shah. And Fatih Shah splurged the national wealth in his hedonistic pleasures, But diplomatically and politically and militarily, he was a disastrous king for Iran. Under Fatih Shah, the Russio-Persian War was waged, in which the Russians annexed Georgia, Azerbaijan, and Armenia. So this is the origin of the separation of these states away from Persia, which was all part of Persia, as Georgia, Azerbaijan, Armenia all went to Russia. However, all the contributions of Qajars were not frivolous. Nasiruddin Mulk Mosque in Shahr Shiraz was built in the dying days of the Qajar Empire, and it is a fine example of exquisite art of Persia. This is also the most photographed mosque in Iran. The Qajar dynasty moved the capital from Shiraz to Tehran. Tehran today is a vibrant metropolis. And despite the cruel sanctions imposed by the West, its life still goes on. The airports are beautiful, the domestic flights are on time, and my experience of Iran and Tehran was brilliant. I think it was a great city to visit. Posters like this are seen all over Iran, and they remind the women that the observing veil is the law of the land. But compliance to this diktat is lax. Some go about in chadars, but a lot of young people hold hands and walk in the streets of Tehran. And you cannot be faulted for thinking that this is Champs-Élysées or it is the Spanish Steps in Rome. This young lady in haute couture is still within the laws of the land only by covering her head. Young couples in Iran can always find a rendezvous, whether in the traditional restaurants or on the tops of Caspian Hills. And Thursday nights in Iran, the weekend begins, the music in the air and celebration around the country. Tehran is a happy city. Tehran is modern, but for sheer opulence, grandeur, and profusion of luxury, the Gulistan Palace built by the Qajars is in class of its own. The exterior of the Qajar Palace, the hall of chandeliers, and this is the marble throne where the first Pahlavi dynasty Shah, the father of the Shah of Iran, took his crown. The last Pahlavi king, the Shah of Iran, desired a more ornate setting for his coronation, and he chose this room in Gulistan Palace for that. This figure is a mannequin, but the rest of the luxury is real. The emperors and kings of Persia received gifts and gave gifts, and these imperial crowns are all stored in the vaults in the basement of the Bank of Milli in downtown Tehran. Iranian emperors received gifts and also gave gifts. Here is a pendant from Tsar Alexander II, which the Qajars received. And they gave gifts, and this is the pendant that Queen Victoria is wearing and has the image of the Qajar ruler on it. In the early 20th century, the Qajars gave not just gifts, but they gave oil concessions to the West. And the entire Iranian territory was given to the British for a mere 400,000 pounds for the exploration of oil. But when a nationalist Qajar ruler followed this frivolous ruler, he did not toe the British line, and the British provoked a rebellion against him and brought to power an army officer by the name of Reza Khan, who we know is the father of the last Shah of Iran. So the British first displaced the Qajar ruler and brought the Shah of Iran the first in place. The Shah did not lose any time, declared himself as the first Pahlavi king, and changed the name of the country from Persia to Iran, which was really the original name of the region. His idol was Mustafa Kamal Pasha. But he admired Mustafa Kamal Pasha for the anti-orthodoxy and secularism. He did not have his class, did not have his following, but the new king decided to westernize the education of Iran, and he banned chadars which women took, and he ordered the restaurants and the cinema theaters not to admit women who were wearing a veil. And he asked all men to wear Western clothes. Reza Shah, however, wanted to display his Shia faith with a very strange Western twist. He walked in Ashura and put the dust and straw on his head to observe piety, but he asked the military band to follow him, as the military band was playing Chopin's music, or the Chopin funeral march. And this was to mourn Hazrat Hussein. But during the Second World War, Reza Shah committed a mistake by siding with the Germans, and for the British, this was a sin they would never forgive. They forced the Shah to step down and brought his son in his place. The son was only 22 years old. Muhammad Reza became king in 1941. He immediately understood what his father had done. It was unpopular. He restored to the Iranians most of the freedom his father had denied, gave the women back the chadars. And although he was a very popular person in this particular regard, but his father was an ultra-nationalist, and he was not. The father did not like the British or the West, but this Shah was completely influenced by the West and played to the tune until his dying days. Under the Shah, the British were in business again, and they bought cheap oil for the war machine. But the public was incensed, and they did not want to see the looted oil go to the West. And a popular leader, Musaddiq, was then in elections, and he was swept into power as the next prime minister of Iran. Musaddiq introduced democracy in 1951 to 53. He clipped the wings of the Shah and his sister Ashraf. He nationalized the oil industry and denied the British oil it badly needed. The British sought the assistance of the Americans to unseat Mossadegh, but the Americans, the President Truman at that time, had nothing to do with it. In fact, he invited Mossadegh to the White House. But in 1953, Churchill convinced Eisenhower that the Russia-loving Mossadegh had to go. And he launched an operation against Mossadegh, and this was done by a CIA whose chief officer was the grandson of President Roosevelt, and his name was Kermit Roosevelt, chief of CIA. Ultimately, Mossadegh was overthrown and the Shah was brought back to power. Mossadegh was given life sentence, but he died 3 years later in captivity. However, 60 years from now, 60 years later, he still lives in the heart of all Iranians. The Shah first became king in 1941, but the coronation took place 26 years later. He took the title of Shahinshah. And when asked why he waited so long, he said, "There was no honor in being a monarch of a country which was so poor." The Shah greatly admired Napoleon and emulated him whenever he could. Now, in this painting, which is at Versailles, Napoleon is shown taking the crown from the hands of the Pope and placing it on his own head. And here, Shah is showing crowning himself. He became the Shahinshah. And then, in a gesture which is reminiscent of the French emperor, who is shown about to place the crown on Josephine's head, the Shah placed the crown on kneeling Faradiba, the new empress of Iran. The Shah was a despotic ruler who was very close to the West, but not close to his own people. There was a conflict, a battle between the crown and the turban. His arrogance and megalomania is reflected in the celebrations he organized in 1971 on the anniversary of the Achaemenid Empire, the 2,500-year anniversary of the Achaemenid Empire. The grand celebrations took place in Pasargadeh, and this is the tomb of Cyrus, which I showed you earlier. And he came to pay respects to Cyrus to declare that the Pahlavi dynasty was a continuation of the Achaemenid period, Achaemenid dynasty. He invited to Persepolis emperors, kings, presidents, and prime ministers from all across the world. He reveled in the company of the greats and those who mattered in the world, but little did he know that 8 years later, when he would need their support, he was denied that. But the winds of change were blowing, and in 1979, Ayatollah Khomeini returned from France to lead the revolution which changed the soul of Iran. The fate of the Shah was sealed. The Shah left Iran on his personal plane. Here is a scene when his officers are besieging him, touching his feet, asking him not to leave the country. And Shah left and sought asylum in the United States and many other countries, was denied. Mexico denied his request. And finally, he died in Egypt. He lies buried in a very small mosque in a country far away from his own, which he ruled so arrogantly. In 1991, he was buried in a small mosque in the center of Cairo. In 1991, I had an opportunity to visit Cairo, and I had so much difficulty locating the grave of the Shah. Not many people knew where he was buried. It was a very simple grave then, but it has all been done up now, and in a lonely corner, only his family comes to grieve him. Some years later, I was in Rangoon to offer Fatiha at the grave of another exiled king, Bahadur Shah Zafar. And what Zafar wrote in his life, and it is written on the walls of his grave, on his mausoleum, applies very aptly to the Shah of Iran. Kitna hai badnaseeb Zafar dafan ke liye, do gaz zameen bhi mil na saki koi yaar. Thank you for your patience.